Welcome to all viewers of this week's edition of the Tenpin Bowling Show. My name's Michael Tran. We're at Berri Bowland for this year's running of the 2009 Riverland Cup, where we have Colin Hunt taking on last week's winner, Anne-Marie Putney. Let's go down the lanes for all the action.
Thank you very much, Michael. This is the semi-final match of the 2009 Riverland Cup at Berri Bowland between Colin Hunt from South Australia and Anne-Marie Putney from New South Wales. Colin Hunt, average of 189.3, and Colin has qualified second, so that gives you a real indication just how tough it was this week. And given that Colin started 126-136, his first two games of qualifying, just getting here is a fair old effort. Now welcome Michael Tran.
Thanks very much, Brenton. And just seeing Colin Hunt's first shot. It was through the nose, taking out the six pin, unfortunately, leaving himself the baby split to pick up. It's a 3-10. A couple of different ways you can attempt to spare this. You can either try and fit the ball between the pins, which Colin's done very successfully. He's done well. The other option is obviously to put the ball on the left-hand side of that front pin. Anne-Marie Putney from New South Wales. She averaged 184.9. That put her in fourth spot overall after qualifying. And she was the successful winner of last week's match.
And that 201 she shot last week mightn't sound a lot, but on this condition, that was sensational.
Oh, is indicative there of how tough the shot was. She's gone through the beak also, but not as fortunate as Colin. She's left an even bigger split, and this more likely to be an open frame.
Only a couple of boards inside the target there, but that was all you needed to do this week. Oh.
At the back pin there, try and jump out.
Let's have a look again. Yeah, that got jammed up between the ball and the pit curtain. And quite often that will send the pin back out onto the pin deck.
Just for people's information, if that pin does come back out onto the deck, it is a live pin, so it does count for anything that it knocks over.
Colin Hunt with an early lead, looking to throw a strike here to consolidate.
Oh, great shot.
Showing the sort of form that saw Colin win the South Pacific Classic in 1999, went on to represent Australia in the World Cup and at a couple of FIQs. Now Colin, also a former South Australian State Rockway team captain. You can see he's a very accomplished player, very much one from the old school. Bit of speed, relatively straight angles. And that's what worked this weekend.
Oh yes, been impressed with his game this week. And Marie finding the pocket again, which is good to see. But leaving at 10 pin.
Better shot, a little bit more positive. And it's difficult with these conditions where you had to throw the ball positively. As soon as you got a little bit careful, your reaction became very, very inconsistent. You had to be positive through the bottom of the swing. Trust yourself to hit the target you're trying to hit. And then go back and make your spares like that.
Yeah, that's very positive bowling from Anne-Marie. As you can see, folks, Colin now has a potential 21-pin lead if he can tack another strike on the end of the one he's just thrown. Too true what you said just before, Brenton, about being positive with the shot. If you tend to get a little bit cautious, it can play around with your ball speed a little bit, and you could not be soft on the ball speed here. You were punished. Let's see what Colin can do at the top of the third. Great reaction.
Carbon copy of the previous shot. Colin's lined up.
Look at this 8-pin go. Oh, gets kicked out by, I think it was the 2-pin on the way through.
Yep. Just got it.
Last thing you wanted to see right there was a solid 8-pin after a shot like that.
Double, a double in this tournament was absolute gold. And Marie now, 21 behind, needs to start throwing some strikes. Oh
no. Have a laugh, AMP. That's great attitude to have when you're on the lanes. That's an awful break. It's a 9-pin. She's playing a little bit more of the centre of the lane, which is where most of the oil was this week.
Reality is, though, you had to approach this weekend with the attitude of just trying to find a way to the pocket. Actually went out there almost trying to shoot, you know, pocket nine counts and take whatever strikes you could get. If you're shooting pocket nine counts, the sparing was a bit easier.
Nine was a good result.
It was, as the averages of the bowlers indicates. Colin now.
What an opportunity this is. You go into the fourth.
That's soft and inside. And he's left that 310 again. You don't want to be leaving this sort of thing too often, because any spare was really tough this weekend. But his old blue hammer there, the old urethane, pearl urethane ball, it might as well be plastic because he doesn't hook it.
Well, that's a good thing on this condition. Having said that, though, the outside of the lane was very slick.
It was.
So it had to be dead on, and he's got it right again. Very impressive.
Making spares like that this week was an absolute bonus. Anytime you left something like that in a spare, that was just, you know, you thanked your lucky stars and went to the next frame figuring you just picked up 10 pins on the field. Might sound like I'm exaggerating, but it was that tough.
And Marie now. Another pocket shot. Very positive though, isn't she?
Oh, she is. Anne Marie, she likes to stay as positive as possible, likes to bowl with a smile.
Leaves the attacking to the pins.
That's right.
She's the most positive bowler going around, I think.
When you've won as many tournaments as Anne Marie's won, it's not hard to be positive.
Oh, you can't complain, can you?
Not at all.
At the top of the world. Now, Colin, to get back on the strike train, hopefully, at the top of the fifth. Oh, good positive shot. Hit the pocket. Ah, the six pin not quite doing the job off the wall.
As I said, this week it was about hitting the pocket and being happy just to leave a corner pin. Because hitting the pocket was the hard part, well and truly.
And look, as accomplished as Colin Hunt is, he doesn't miss too many of those. Doesn't miss much of anything, really.
Very, very seldom misses Colin. Very, very solid spare shooter.
Now, Anne-Marie has an opportunity to get that strike back and draw this game almost to an even keel.
And a little extra time. You've got to like that one. Got to like that one.
Yeah, great shot. She knows how important that was. Deep breath. As she takes a break, we're going to visit George Philingos with George's bowling tips. To those viewers that have just recently been introduced to the sport of 10-pin, we're currently on the lanes at the moment just to explain a little bit how oil condition works. In bowling centres, they choose the oil pattern that each of the bowlers bowls on, and it's up to the bowler in that case how they're to use that oil on the lane, how best to score. Now, different types of bowlers that like to bowl up the side of the lane or bowlers that like to spin the ball a lot, can use that oil to their advantage. A bowler with not as much revolutions on the ball might like to play up the side of the lane where there is little or no oil, and that way they can get their ball to rotate back into the pocket. Those bowlers with a lot of revolutions may like to use that oil to their advantage, because the more they play through the oil, the ball will skid and find its way eventually back into the pocket. This weekend at Berri Bowland, the shot was quite difficult, and it was really up to the bowler to make the correct adjustments, find a way to the pocket, and score well. What you're seeing at the moment on the telecast is a very good example of how the high-level bowlers have been able to do that.
And we're back for the semi-final match of the 2009 Riverland Cup from Berri Bowland in South Australia. And thank you, Michael, for that little insight to the condition we had this weekend. Colin Hunt now looking to get back on the strike train.
Oh, almost done that to effect. Let's have a look at Collins' form. Gets to the line nice and smooth. He tends to turn his body at arrival off the foul line. I think that allows him to get the ball out straight. And the 10-pin just standing there, unfortunately. Look, it was an idea, and let's just give the viewers a little bit of an idea as to what the lane condition was like. It was very much like that little caption in the break. To the bowlers had to find the oil, what little oil there was, and it was strategically placed in a way that it was very difficult to use.
Unlike most league conditions where the outside boards are very dry, here this week the outside boards were very, very wet.
So there was nothing to bounce off of if you threw it too wide. It was
And if you threw it inside, there was not enough there to hold it to the pocket either. You just had to, wherever you shot, you just had to split a board.
Anne-Marie going into the sixth frame. Through the beacon, catching another break. She didn't leave 310. Kicks out the 10 with a 6-pin. No, we can't, say exactly how much in words how tough it was this week. To bowlers that only bowl on typical house shots, there was absolutely no margin for error. None at all. In a typical house shot, you could basically throw the ball maybe to the right or left-hand side, wherever you like to play, depending on which hand you bowl with, and be able to find the pocket most comfortably. But on this particular condition, as you can see, the bowler's starting to do at the moment. There's not so many strikes coming. The minutest change in shot of speed, rotation, is going to leave a pin.
This week was all about playing percentages. After the practice session on Friday night, I turned around to someone and said, reminded me of the old City Bowl in Adelaide shot from many, many years ago. Everyone was playing tight, deep lines just like that.
Yeah, that's tremendous. Great shot at the top of the seventh. Colin Hunt showing us why he's a former Australian representative. Lovely shot. And I tell you, City Bowl in Adelaide has been closed for a number of years. And a lot of the South Australian bowlers used to bowl there.
It closed down about 15 years ago, and the place in its 30-odd year history had one 300 game, and the high three-game series, and the place was only about 740. I have to say that was where I learned to play deep inside. Oh, that's a lovely shot there from Anne-Marie, and certainly back in the pocket there.
Deep inside there, deep inside the 1-3 pocket. Lovely shot. Put a strike on the board. And this is a 9-pin game, folks. This has tightened up all of a sudden. I think we're in for a very, very tense three frames.
Colin Hunt now really looking to build on his score thus far. This one's very, very tight indeed, this match.
Just thrown across. And
there's that flat 10 again, but he's not concerned about that. He's staying in the pocket. And really, that's what this week was about. Old-style bowling, playing percentages, just trying to stay around the pocket, making your spares.
Look, he's been great in his telecast, Colin. He's only missed the pocket twice and has been able to pick up the spares that weren't in the pocket. So, look, he's given himself every chance of going on and attempting to claim the 2009 Riverland Cup.
The mentality this week was just completely different to any other tournament that you bowl in Australia, and certainly different to your league.
The only disadvantage, I suppose, Colin Hunt has right now is that he is down on count. So he's one pin down on count at the moment, depending on what Anne-Marie does here. And if she gets a double, she's ahead. So what can she do? Oh, nearly getting the kick off the wall from the 6-pin. And it's that carry that is keeping Colin Hunt in the game right now. Look at that, off the wall, just doesn't get the kick on the 10.
It's almost like going back to the 70s and early 80s where, you know, nearly everyone played, you know, really straight and tight angles.
And bowling balls didn't hook back then.
And these guys, I mean, they're both throwing aggressive bowling balls, but they're not hooking it much, and you didn't want to hook it much this week.
Yeah, basically every bowling ball sold on the market these days is hook in a box, isn't it? It's designed to be able to just throw it down there, and if you got it in the pocket any which way you liked, it would normally carry. But you went back to the old days, I suppose you could say, if I'm allowed to say that, and you went back to throwing that straight line, just finding that two or three boards a hook in the back end, and that's all you wanted.
Wow.
I think Colin needed a lot more back then, but...
Lost that one at the bottom of the swing that time. Lost it, got nothing on it. Probably got a hair quick with the feet.
Yeah, that's the first time Colin's missed the head pin. And look, he's got to cover it up here.
Going with his spare ball again. But as I said, there were no gimmies this week. Everything had to be spot on.
Oh, look out. The ball didn't deflect off the head pin to carry the 8 pin at the back.
Colin tends to throw that one pretty hard and straight, and he could have done with just a little bit of tail then to deflect that ball into the 8 pin. Now Anne-Marie has a massive opportunity, huge opportunity.
Any mark will give her the lead. But look, having said that, I don't think that shot was that bad from Colin. In fact, that he picked up his strike ball. One would suggest that the ball may have hooked too much, and generally it did this week if you missed inside.
Yeah, it looked like Anne-Marie tried to really stuff that one in there, and you couldn't do that this week. It was almost like you had to forget about everything past your target and just try and execute a positive shot through that target and adjust off what happened beyond that.
Yeah, you're right. If you got it perfect in the first 40 feet... You were pretty right in the back 20.
Mm, absolutely. That's a great spare there from Anne-Marie, and now she effectively has a 13-pin lead.
But look, Colin needs to do something positive here with that lead that was spoken about. I think it's only 3 pins. But look, Colin is now down on count, so he really needs to put some strikes on the board. This is the time to do it. This is the 10th frame, folks. We're in for a close one. Let's see what he can do. Oh, hook!
Massive, massive break.
Emery enjoyed that. I'm not too sure why. That ball turned a long way and has caught the carry. That's a massive break for Colin. Now all he has to do is put another one on the end of it.
Well, there were a lot of Brooklands this week. Everyone, and I mean absolutely everyone, had a ton of Brooklands.
I'm surprised we haven't seen one Brooklyn side yet in the telecast. But in this frame, Anne-Marie Putney needs to do what Colin Hunt does. If he puts a strike on right now, Anne-Marie needs to put two together.
It's a bit wide, bit wide.
Not quite getting back the pocket. And because Colin's now down on count, all Anne-Marie needs to do... is close with her first ball. I think Colin knows that. He's just getting out the way now.
Well, Anne-Marie, if she were to not strike on this first ball, if she were to throw a nine count and spare it, she would have to throw another nine to win by one. Effectively, it comes down to this ball, really. She throws a strike here. I won't say it's all over, but she's certainly got 1 foot into the final.
Yeah, if she strikes on the first shot, all she needs is 9. And I know that was tough enough to do this week.
It was. So no gimmies whatsoever. See what you can do here. That, oh, no!
Oh, that one's gone as well. Get the guns out. Anne-Marie Putney has crushed a Brooklyn side. I don't even think it made Brooklyn, but it carried everything. Everything in its path.
In the States, they would call that one a Jersey squasher. Very, very high Brooklyn. It just kind of snowplowed everything back into the pit.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, she still needs to get out and throw a decent shot. There have been a lot of low counts thrown this week. Not that one.
Oh, that's 8. And look, that's enough. That is enough, folks.
That's right.
That takes her to 193. And throwing a spare ball just to get out the way. Takes one. And boy, what a close finish that was, folks. Anne-Marie Putney continues to climb the step ladder. She takes out Colin Hunt. 194 to 192. Boy, that was, well, just so close.
Went right down to the last frame, and that's what we like to see.
Okay, folks, what an exciting finish it was to that game. Very, very close in the end, 194 to 192 scoreline. Anne-Marie Putney continues to climb the ladder. Brenton Davey, give us a quick rundown of the match.
Well, it was very close all the way through. Both players were playing percentage shots, just trying to hit the pocket and just taking what they could get. Next week, they come up against George Frelingos. Anne-Marie, she's been hitting the pocket pretty regularly. George is probably the only person who's been successful from the outside line. Too close to call. I wouldn't like to say who'd win.
It's going to be a very, very close match, folks. Return next week to see George Frelingos take on the ever-rising Anne-Marie Putney. From the Temping Bowling Show, it's goodbye.